Hello and welcome to Rich TV. Today we have a great person here in our studio with us. It's William Pike, the digital director of Radio Africa Group, author of Combatants, a memoir of the Bush War and the press in Uganda. The editor, was it the editor, William?
And managing director.
Of New Vision.
The national newspaper in Uganda.
Of Uganda, but that's hardly describes William, but... We'll add in. Now, William, today we're going to be talking about your book, which is called Combatants, a memoir of the Bush War and the press in Uganda, which I've read and enjoyed thoroughly. And I wanted to start by just situating you a little bit, because it starts in your childhood, William, and it seems very idyllic when I was reading through it. You were somewhere by the sea, in Tanzania. You described spending days on the seashore, and it seemed to me those were extremely happy days. How did you begin in Tanzania? What were you doing there? How did that come about?
Well, my father was a colonial officer.
District officer?
I was born in 1952,
yes.
But my father arrived from Ireland via the colonial officer cadet course in Oxford,
yes,
in Tanganyika in 1926 as an assistant district officer. He ended up becoming the Minister of Mines and Lands in Tanganyika. When I was born, he was the provincial commissioner of Southern Province in Lindi, which is on the Mozambique border.
Oh, goodness. Oh, right. So is that where you spent your early days?
Not really. Those are the days I can't remember. But we, after being in Lindi, we moved to Dar es Salaam, and those were the days that you're talking about, where every Sunday, because my father was a senior government official,
yes,
they had a beach house just south of Dar es Salaam on a long beach called Injimwema, which had about six. I mean, this is obviously some kind of colonial appropriation, but there was a long beach, maybe a kilometre long, with six or seven beach houses on it, allocated to senior government officers. So you'd have the fisher people, women walking up and down with turned inside out octopuses up and down the beach, but really just a very lovely place to be a kid.
And in one part of the book, you actually go back and it's now a government office, I think.
No, that was actually our old house.
Ah.
Had been turned into...
In Dar es Salaam.
In Dar es Salaam. Just, it was at the back gate of State House in Dar es Salaam. And it had been turned into an office for the Ministry of Lands. And it had surveyors and draftsmen in there. And I went in and wandered around. This was in 1982 when I went back and introduced myself. And they were very friendly, but slightly baffled when I said, this is the bedroom I used to...
yes.
And it was...
So here you are, you're the son of an officer in the colonial service in Tanzania, Tanganyika in those days. That's where you're brought up. When did you come back to the UK to study?
Well, my father retired as independence neared, not so much because it was independence, but because he was an older father, and he didn't want to send his children to boarding school. So we went back to England in 1959, and I went to school in England. But then, after university, when I became a journalist,
yes,
you know, if you're a journalist, you want to find things that interest you to write about. And I was, because of my memories of Africa and studying Africa, I was interested in writing about Africa. So then in 1982, I went back to be a freelance journalist.
But before you get to that point, I mean, what I found interesting was, you know, there's this term called woke. You were quite woke, you know, at that age, at quite a young age. What sort of, given that you'd sort of had experience via your father, the colonial service, and then to come back to the UK, reading your book, you made friends with, you know, all kinds of people. You had quite a sort of open outlook on the world. It was seemed to me, you know, you were quite politically ahead of the curve at that point in time. What was the trigger for that? Was that your father, or was that people you met at university and school?
No, I think that was actually the times, yes. Because there was the hippie movement in the 1960s, which I got involved with. I was a hippie.
Yes, but then went to Afghanistan.
Yes, but then I went to university, York University in the north of England, which was the sociology students ruled the roost.
Ah.
And
So
the hippie thing was bourgeois and backward, and you had to be politically active. So somehow I sort of moved on to being from the Cultural Revolution to left-wing politics, and was involved in the Labour Party.
Who was the leader of the Labour Party at that time?
It was sort of the Michael Foottime, really.
Yes.
When it was, but and Neil Kinnock and whatnot. So I was in Notting Hill Gate and Stoke Newington, where I lived in London.
And at the same time, this was preceding this, of course, was the whole independence wave. And had you sort of experienced that or felt?
Well, I hadn't experienced that particularly. But the way I got involved in Ugandan politics,
yes,
was that I'd sort of become left-wing, and I was in the Labour Party, but I found it was unbearably bureaucratic and tedious, and you'd go to these long meetings, and it was all points of order, procedure, objection, and it was just too tedious. And then I'd been to Tanganyika, Tanzania, in 1982 as a freelance journalist, but Tanzania had serious economic crisis at that time, and it seemed hopeless. And I'd gone back to Tanzania expecting it to be a Shangri-La.
Yes, quite optimistic, and then you were very let down.
Yes, and we, as a sort of left-wing person, you read about Ujamaa and African socialism, and you expected it to be not a rich place, but some kind of communal utopia.
And
it wasn't. It was, you couldn't get anything. It was, people were really struggling. People were fed up. And so then I came back to SOAS, the School of Oriental and African Studies, where I did a master's. And then I bumped into Ugandan members of the National Resistance Movement, which was Yoweri Museveni's guerrilla army, which had just started fighting a bush war against Milton Obote. So this was 1982. They'd been fighting for just over a year. And then
So these were the party cadres in the UK studying or lobbying?
They were Ugandan exiles. So in those days, SOAS was full of refugees from Africa, from the ANC and different political groups. Many of them were exiles. So the Ugandans I met were all exiles, and there wasn't a formal structure, but they were mobilizing and working for the NRA, or the NRM, the National Resistance Army. And I found them very inspirational, because they seemed very decent, honest people. They had ideas about how to change and fix Africa, and it was a sharp contrast to what I'd seen just a few months earlier in Tanzania, where there seemed to be some kind of torpor and stagnation and a failure to find a way out of their economic crisis.
So what you're saying is SOAS was a hotbed of African Pan-Africanism and African nationalism at that time.
And I had very much that progressive left-wing politics mentality.
Yes.
So I was very happy to meet these guys and become friends with them.
Okay, so here you are, you're doing your master's. I think you were writing at the same time for
South Magazine. Yes. And doing some stuff for the BBC and...
Okay, just, all Africa-related.
Yeah, all Africa-related, yeah. Africa-related. Well, except in South Magazine I wrote about other places as well.
Yes, but you didn't quite agree with the philosophy of South Magazine.
No, the problem with South Magazine, which some of people watching may remember it, was...
I remember it.
They thought if you support the Third World, as it was called then, you shouldn't criticize the Third World. Mm. Yet, obviously, some developing countries had a lot of things wrong,
yes,
which you should point out if they're going to be fixed. And I think where I had a problem with South was after I went to... visit Museveni,
yes,
in the bush in 1984, which was a big international story. I mean, it was on the front page of many papers.
Oh, you got the front page of The Observer.
Yes, and also, but even the front page of Liberation,
yes,
on Monday, that was Sunday, on Monday morning, the front page of Liberation, the whole thing was about this visit to the bush. And South didn't want to publish it, and they sandwiched the story. They shrunk it, and they sandwiched it between two pro Obote articles to contextualize it. But actually, they ended up getting egg on their face because it was a big, very big international story for multiple reasons. And they sabotaged themselves because they thought they had to be fair to,
yes,
the third world or to Uganda, forgetting that 250,000 people had died in Uganda since 1981, between 1981.
Under Obote.
Yes.
So just going back to SOAS, here you are, you're meeting all these revolutionaries from the NRM, NRA. How did this idea come about to go to Uganda? I mean, you know, was it a Hail Mary pass request? Was it, how did you?
No, what it was, if you're a freelance journalist,
yes,
which is what I was at that stage, you're always hunting for a big story that can get you on the front page of a newspaper,
yes,
you know, you just want to get that big story, that big fish.
Is that the breakthrough trade?
Yeah. So that was, what I like these people,
yes,
but I was also interested in Africa. I sort of got to know about their struggle,
yes,
at that stage the real motivation to go there was to get a big story. Was then I went there in 84,
yes,
and it was extremely dangerous.
But why did they pick on you?
They didn't pick on me. I was like number three or four or five down the line. First of all, they wanted to take a Granada film crew, but then they couldn't get a guarantee to get their cameras in. Then they wanted someone called Richard Carver to go, who was the editor of Africa Now magazine, if you remember those magazines. And who was also a good friend of mine. So I kept saying to Ben Matogo, who was the London representative of the NRM, Ben, let me go. If these other people don't want to go, I can go.
Yes.
And eventually my name got to the head of the queue because other people, they wanted to take Reuters as well.
Yes.
But Reuters dropped out because they thought it was too dangerous and they didn't want to risk sending one of their people. So eventually I got to the top of the queue. I think I also believed that I would survive the trip, because it was very dangerous, because I trusted these people and I'd built up personal friendships with them. Whereas I think Reuters, it was just another African guerrilla saying, would you send someone from Reuters, a reporter, to the bush? And probably they didn't know whether to trust them or not, but because I built up a friendship, I felt I could trust them.
It was quite a leap in the dark for you at that time, don't you think? You know, back on it. And, you know,
it was.
Were you nervous? Were you scared? Or
I mean, if you read the book, there's you know, like there's moments of adrenaline rush, there's moments of terror, of frustration. But actually, what I always tell Ugandans,
yes,
is the really scary bit was being in Kampala in those days, because there was shooting at night, you know, people, you know, there would be dead bodies on the street, there were people being arrested all the time and taken for interrogation, and if you're taken for interrogation, normally you'd end up being dumped in a killing field. It was very, very scary for Ugandans. And what I tell Ugandans when they ask, wasn't it scary? I say, being in the bush was far, with the guerrillas, was far less scary than being in Kampala.
Wow.
Much less scary, because okay, sometimes there'd be some shooting or some bombs, but you know, you're with 20 or 30 or 50 guerrillas. I mean, if there's gonna be a fight, they're gonna get killed as well. So whereas in Kampala, you're on your own, whether it's me or a permanent resident of
actually,
Kampala.
That passage when you get there and you describe, I think it's going, you know, staying at somebody's house before you leave Kampala is actually a very nerve-wracking in its description.
Yes, because we failed. We tried to get out of Kampala. They tried to drive me to near where the guerrillas were, but we got stopped at a roadblock, and some of the people in the car who were guerrillas in plain clothes got arrested, and then I had to go with the leader of the cell and sleep at his house, and I ended up walking 120.
He wasn't too happy about that idea, I don't think.
He was scared, you know. Yes. But when they became really scared, the Kampala cells, when I came back from the bush, mm, and I'd seen what you were not supposed to see,
yes,
which is this incredibly organized, small, you know, probably about 5,000 people in the guerrilla army, about 3,000 of them with guns, but incredibly organized, incredibly disciplined, incredibly idealistic, which is what people often forget and people should remember despite whatever trajectory modern Ugandan politics has taken. Having seen that, which is what I shouldn't have seen and what was dangerous to see, that's when the people in Kampala, the clandestine operatives, were frightened to be with me, because what I'd seen would get me killed and would get them killed if I was caught. So they basically, once I got back, they took me down to the bus park and shoved me into a taxi to go to the Kenyan border and hightailed it off.
So let's go back now. You're in Kampala. You now get spirited. You get taken to meet the guerrillas. There's this extraordinary description of quite a long journey that you had to take.
120 kilometers walking.
Walking, and you had a problem with your legs, if I remember.
My feet got swollen.
Very swollen. The bush, you obviously, I recommend everyone read the book, and you can get it on Amazon, you can get it in the bookstores here in Nairobi. But you, 120 kilometer walk, you're with people that really you didn't know, did you?
No. Stage.
Could you communicate with them?
Yeah. I mean, they were very sophisticated people.
Yes.
I mean, and in fact, there was I had a personal escort called Kale Kayohura, who ended up being the head of the police in Uganda.
Yes.
And he escorted me for most of the time, the 2 weeks I was in the bush. The first time, we were walking out of a forest with about a single file of about 30 guerrillas. It's about 5 p.m. and it's just coming to twilight. And then a voice, this is 1984,
yeah,
and a voice behind me goes, "So what is your analysis of the miners' strike?"
In the UK?
That was Kale Kayohura, this voice behind me, saying, "What is who?" And so he'd been a student at LSC who dropped out of doing a master's in law at LSC to go and fight in the bush via a Libyan training camp. And so when you say, could you communicate? So you actually, it was incredibly easy to communicate. But the guy goes, what's your analysis of the miners' strike? Okay, then we talk about the miners' strike for half an hour. No, it was very easy to communicate.
Quite surreal.
It was surreal, but also beautiful in a way, because these people were really passionate about changing the world for the better. I mean, Uganda was their laboratory, as it were. But I mean, they were very interested in politics, global issues. They were well informed, despite being in the bush, because they listened to
BBC
World Service.
Yes.
So actually, it was very interesting to communicate to them, to communicate with them, and it wasn't difficult to communicate with them.
They weren't a ragtag army,
the officers were mainly university graduates, and often from Western Uganda, often from families who were. There was a revivalist movement in the 1940s and 50s in Uganda called Balokali, like for local, Balokali. And many of the officers, including Museveni, came from these Balokali families. But then the foot soldiers were mostly Baganda peasant farmer stock. So there was the officers tended to be more educated than the soldiers, but there was a mix. You know, it wasn't strictly 100% like that, but that was a pattern.
Now, obviously, the breakthrough in this was obviously to have an interview with Museveni, right? I mean, that was what part of the story was. The other part was to sort of ventilate what was actually happening in this area, because it was being represented in a certain way in the media. So 120 kilometers, do you get yourself in front of Museveni?
Yeah, so eventually I got there, and I spent 2 days talking and interviewing him.
Personally?
Yes, and you know, it was just him, and actually it was just him, but he had someone sitting beside him with a cap pulled over his head, who was doing civilian intelligence. And that was someone who also became a general, General Mugisha Muntu, who's now an opposition leader in today's Ugandan politics. So it was just Museveni, me and Muntu for 2 days.
Whenever I've listened to you speak about Museveni, you've always spoken of him as if he was a real, an intellectual, somebody to be admired. Describe to us those 2 days. Was he? What did he have a coherent worldview? Did he impress you? What were your impressions? If I put you back in that day,
I think it's always very important not to have hindsight, and so one of the reasons I wanted to write the book is to show things as they were then, rather than looking at through the lenses of today's politics in Uganda. And Museveni was an extraordinary and inspirational person in those days. He did have a very coherent political philosophy. I mean, both in terms of he believed in underdevelopment theory, and you know, Walter Rodney had been his teacher at the University of Dar es Salaam. So he was not, the British government was incredibly paranoid that he was a hardcore Marxist, but actually he believed in a mixed economy, but getting a good deal for Uganda and developing countries. But so he's intellectually very, he was very strong, and he's very interested in military history. And he would expound, you could talk to him about military history, and he wouldn't start talking about Mao, he talked a bit about Mao Zedong, but then he'd also start, I asked him, who is your favorite general?
Was it Clarkson?
Montgomery.
Oh, really?
So, you know, because the most impressive thing was that in those days, Uganda was very chaotic, very dangerous, very anarchic. Yet here you had this highly disciplined, organized guerrilla group that really had been created from nothing. There were no, One of the things that's historically important in terms of military history is that the Uganda guerrillas, NRA, received no external support, or let's say negligible, because in 1981, Gaddafi sent them one consignment of arms in 1981, which was shared with another guerrilla group. But you're talking about 140 rifles or something, not a lot.
So how did they arm them?
They armed themselves by capturing guns from the government army. They had no external support.
So it was a raiding strategy.
Yes, and they lived off food from given to them by local people. So that is I think it's only Cuba and China and Uganda where you've had successful guerrilla struggles which have captured state power without external support. So historically, that's very important. And that, to some large extent, is Museveni deserves the credit for. So as well as being intellectually very clear-headed and creating this nationalist manifesto for Uganda, he actually organized the military struggle, which was ultimately successful, which was a huge achievement. And it was clear to me by the time I'd spent 2 weeks in Uganda in 1984
that it was going to succeed,
it was going to capture power.
Because at that time, everyone was highly skeptical that he would succeed. I remember, in your book and other things I've read, Obote was seen, this was seen as some kind of skirmish that he was going to put
out.
Bandits.
So actually, Museveni asked me to go and see the British Foreign Office when I got back.
On his behalf?
Not so much on his behalf, but to tell them what I'd seen.
Yes.
So I went to the King Charles Street, and they took me up into a garret right in the roof of the Foreign Office, and there was about 20 people there, of all sorts, I knew some of them were from the East Africa Department, but I don't know who the other ones were. And I told them Museveni is going to capture power.
You said that?
Yes, and they all looked at me, another bleeding heart liberal, another nutter, another dupe. But actually a year later, approximately a year later, there was a coup in 1985, in July 85.
How soon after you saw him did he capture power?
A year and a half, basically. So I was there in July 84, and they captured power in January 86. So, but a year later,
after the Foreign Office, and say, well, this is a guy who knew what he was talking about.
Not really, no. But I bumped into, at functions, I would bump into some of them, and they changed their tune in 1985 after the coup. They could see the regime was collapsing. But they remained terrified until the very end that Museveni was a hardcore Marxist and he would damage British interests in East Africa. Even though I not just me, but many other people had said, actually, he's not a Marxist. He's actually something like, if you can call him something, he's a socialist. He's more like the Labour Party. He believed in a mixed economy, but they didn't believe it until the British government only changed its line when Linda Chawker came to Uganda just about a couple of weeks after they captured power. Because the then British High Commissioner had said to Museveni, "Now, we're willing to support you and continue with our aid on condition that you don't massacre anyone," which was deeply insulting to Museveni, because the whole line of the NRA was the problem of Africa is not people, the problem is leaders, and it's leaders who are misguiding people. So they had no intention of massacring people, and so what the British High Commissioner said was very offensive. And then Linda Chawker came out. I think she was Minister of Overseas Development at that stage.
I remember, yes.
Yeah, and she sort of struck a rapport with Museveni. And at that point, British government policy changed to being supportive of Museveni.
So now let's let's jump forward. You are then invited to be the managing director of the main newspaper in Uganda.
Well, it's actually they set up a new, the old government newspaper had collapsed, and using the Russian printing press.
Russian? From,
yes, we printed 4 pages only, but it was Russian.
Putin is back now as well.
Yes. They set up a new government newspaper called The New Vision, and they asked me to come and edit it. They actually asked 2 Ugandans before me. Again, I was the third choice. But by the time they asked me, I had no inkling that I was going to be asked to do the job. I was back in London, working at my desk at South Magazine, and I got a call from Ria Katagaya, saying, did I want to, cabinet had just been sitting and wanted to know if I would be interested in being the editor of this new newspaper. Which of course I was very interested. And a few months later I was in Uganda, and there I spent 20 years, very happy years, editing The New Vision and actually running the business side of it as well.
And actually we saw some of the stories you broke. I think it must have been quite a fantastic 2 decades.
It was, and The New Vision was a government newspaper. It was,
were you editorially free to say whatever you wanted?
Yes, we were absolutely free, and in fact at that stage in late 80s, early 1990s, Uganda was much freer than Kenya. Because in that was the stage where Moi, President Moi, was in charge in Kenya, and there was a lot of media repression. Uganda was very, very open at that stage. I think it's a bit less open now, but in those days it was very open. And ambassadors often used to ask me, how open is it? And I used to say, well, tell me one story you think should have been in the papers, either The New Vision or the other papers that has not appeared in the papers. And they always failed to come up with a story. But basically everything was there. And one story I tell in the book,
yes,
is there was only one time we had outright censorship.
Yes.
And that was the CIA had set up a listening station in Fort Portal during, yes, the Congo War. I think this was 1998.
To listen to the Congo.
To listen to whatever was going on in the Congo. So there was a house in Fort Portal that had US Marines standing outside it on guard at the gate, and then antenna and dishes bristling on the roof. And Hillary Clinton was visiting the following week.
Fort Portal?
No, visiting Kampala. And we rang up the American embassy for a comment, and they gave it's the policy of the American government never to comment on anything concerning intelligence or something like that. Then at 8 o'clock, I got a call from the Minister of Information. The Americans are a bit upset about this story. Can you take it out? But why? Shows the Americans also involved in the Congo struggle. It's good for Uganda. So he rang off. 9 o'clock, the head of intelligence rings.
Ugandan
head of intelligence. You know, this story is going to cause us a lot of problems with Americans. They're really nervous about it coming out. You know, they're our friends. So can't you please take it out? Then I said, okay, fair enough. We'll take it out. It's not as if it's a story that's important for Ugandans. It's not life or death or important for democracy in Uganda. It may be important for democracy globally. So let's take it out. And I thought about leaving it blank, the space blank, saying this space has been left blank at the request of the American embassy. But no. So, and then the next morning, the head of the press attaché of the American embassy had to come over, came to my office. And I think it was very embarrassing for him, because you know, they always preach freedom of speech, democracy, accountability. And he said, well, I've just come here on behalf of the ambassador to say thank you very much for taking that story out of the paper yesterday. So while I was the editor of The New Vision, that is the only piece of outright censorship.
Let me take you to another bit. You've segued into the Congo, you know, so during this period, you know, that you're describing when Museveni came to power, there was also a period when Clinton described Museveni and Kagame as the new 21st century African politicians. There was a period when they were quite active in the region militarily, whether it's the Congo, whether it's the overthrow in the early 90s, of the Rwandan regime, the genocide. How do you see, did that philosophy come from Museveni's idea of Pan-Africanism, of what you've described? And how would you characterize that period?
So in January 86, after they captured power, South magazine sent me to do an interview with Museveni. Yeah, and so at that time, I asked Museveni what he thought the significance of the Ugandan revolution was.
Yes.
This capture of power. And he said, it's going to tell dictators across Africa that they can't be complacent anymore, that the people can rise up and overthrow them. So I think there was a philosophy of people can fight for justice using guerrilla tactics and methods. And I think that spilled into the Rwandan war when RPF invaded.
A lot of the RPF was sort of educated and brought up in Uganda.
The Rwandan, the RPF leadership were mostly Ugandan, inverted commas. In that they'd grown up and been to Makerere University. And many of them had been in the NRA and fought in the Bush War. Sometimes people didn't even, Museveni, I think, knew that they were plotting to go, but he didn't, he was caught by surprise when it happened. And actually, he was surprised about some of the people that went, because he would say, oh, that captain who went, I didn't realize he was Rwandese or Munyarwanda.
Oh, really? So he'd sort of absorb them as Ugandans in a way.
Yeah, because in Uganda, the Buganda, the central area of Uganda, was very rich and was a coffee-rich area. And they had a lot of, in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s, had a lot of migrant labor from Burundi and Rwanda, some of whom were Tutsis. So you could actually have people, you would think they were in Uganda, but actually in his head he knows he's Rwandese or a Tutsi. So, or not necessarily a Tutsi, even a Hutu. So a lot of those people upped sticks and joined the NRA, but when the RPF split off to go, they joined in. So I think these were visionaries, and they were men of the future. They had a lot of ideas. At that time, in the 1990s, the Ugandan economy was growing at 10% a year.
I remember.
And corruption was not really a problem. The country seemed to be coming together again. Yes, there was some, you know, an ongoing insurgency in northern Uganda.
Kony. Do you agree with that story that a lot of people think that some Kony was played up in order to continue that?
First of all, Uganda, northern Uganda is peaceful today. Northern Uganda has been peaceful for about 15 years. What would have been the motive? The argument was that some army officers didn't want to end it because they were getting allowances for fighting the war, and a lot of, you know, they get money in their pocket. But actually, it's very difficult defeating a guerrilla army, or, you know, even if it's a ragtag outfit like Joseph Kony and the Lord's Resistance Army. And the fact is, the Americans poured in. After Kony moved to Congo and Central African Republic, the Americans poured in huge amounts of money, material, intelligence gathering, They had their own special forces chasing Kony. Because, you know, the guy's elusive, you know, that's like 20 people, 50 people, 100 people kind of flitting through, you know, the forest of Central African Republic. It's difficult to find people. I mean, it's not, my point is that it's not easy to catch some of these people. And you also have to remember at that stage, Kony was being supported by the Sudan government. So if things were getting hot in Uganda, he would move into Sudan, stay there, get resupplied by the Sudanese intelligence as a counterbalance to the SPLA, which the Uganda government was supporting.
Yeah, and continues to support the
sort of they're supporting Salva Kiir, yes.
Okay, so let's now jump forward a little bit. You know, we're now at this phase. Museveni's been in power for quite a long time. You've got this. You've got a lot of challenges to his time. I remember a famous quote from him saying that, you know, you have a finite shelf life as a politician. How do you see the current scenario in Uganda?
I think it's quite tricky. I think Museveni is still essentially a good person and a patriot who's doing his best for Uganda as he sees it. But I think when you stay in power for a long time, some people get frustrated, or many people get frustrated. I think 65% of the population is under the age of 30.
Is this not a problem now across the continent?
Yes.
I keep seeing this statistic. But the oldest leaders and the youngest population.
Yes. I mean, that's certainly true in Cameroon and other places. But so those kids have not seen a Uganda where Museveni is not the leader. So it then becomes very easy to, some problems in Uganda are structural problems of an emerging economy, a developing economy. Some problems are to do with the government and the weaknesses of the government. But when you've had no other leader for 30 years, everything gets blamed on the government or President Museveni, because people can't disentangle what's a structural, fundamental problem for society and what's due to the inefficiency or limitations of the government. So I think that's a big issue. There's elections coming in a year, and I think it'll be a more hotly contested election than past elections, where Museveni's always had used his power base in rural areas to...
Is that power base still intact?
It's still there, but because as time passes, because it's becoming eroded.
Because if you look at it on a pan-African basis, the cities have become hotbeds of opposition. Mm. Whether you look at Zimbabwe today and... You know, and the rural areas, what all these sort of liberation parties, although Museveni was kind of post-independence liberation, have relied on. But you're saying that is not as intact as it was?
Well, I think what's happened is that in the rural areas, the government has been very good at providing what small farmers want, because Uganda's still a primarily or overwhelmingly rural economy.
And a very rich rural economy.
Well, it's rich soil, but it could be much better organized.
Yes.
But the security, Uganda is actually a pretty safe
secure
country. Yes, it's a pretty safe country. There's so the transport, the road network has been greatly improved. Electricity has been extended to many parts of the country. So I think for the rural population, especially security, they've got what they need. They don't want to rock the boat. And because they're not so educated, I guess, they tend to be more conservative and stick with what they know, which is President Museveni. And Museveni is very good at going around different parts of the country.
I follow him on social media.
Yeah.
He is extremely active in terms of going to...
And he does micro politics. He knows the leaders. He learns lots of bits of different local languages. So he's good at connecting. But I think you can over-exaggerate the disassociation between town and country.
Yes.
And because the people from the cities, who you rightly say have become oppositional, they still have houses in the village and they go back for weekends or for Christmas or for holidays. And they speak to local people.
What you're saying,
they speak to local, you know, to the village people. And they will also be communicating their concerns or frustration. So there may be some time lag, but I think the cities eventually influence the opinion in the country, because people tend to look up in the country, may tend to look up to, you know, someone who's gone and become a senior civil servant in Kampala or a businessman or something.
And how do you see the future? I mean, you know, there's all this promise of Total. I saw just before we went to do our interview today, I saw that the president of Total has been to visit Museveni this morning. You know, he's been talking about that oil now in the Lake Albert Basin for a long time. You understand, you were there for 2 decades. Is the economy, you know, is it going to lift off? Is it going to happen?
I think the oil is a very interesting test case for what you might see as the vision of Museveni.
Yes.
Or the limitations of President Museveni. Because the oil was discovered, I think, in about 2005.
Yes.
And they would be pumping oil now, except for President Museveni's insistence that there should be an oil refinery on Lake Albert in western Uganda, where the oil is. Because the oil refinery will give added value. Why should Africa export raw materials without processing them first? So the deal, I think, with Total and China National Oil Corporation is that there will be an oil refinery, but it'll be a fairly small oil refinery, just doing processing enough fuel to serve eastern Congo, Uganda, southern Sudan, Rwanda. And possibly Western Kenya also. And they're building, as part of, not only are they building the main pipeline, which will go to Tanga for the crude oil, but they're also building this fuel pipeline at the moment, or they're planning it to go to a fuel depot in central Uganda. So in a way that, you know, there's two sides to every coin.
It's interesting, the point you're saying, he because he'd be such a big believer in value addition, he's refused to sell that oil without it being value added.
At least part of it being value added.
Yes, because I remember...
So is that standing up for what is right, or is that naivete?
Yes.
I mean, it's a double-edged sword, two sides of the coin.
No, very interesting. But however, there's also criticism that they've spent some money already because they had an oil fund.
Yeah, they've borrowed ahead against future oil revenues, yes. I mean, to do Chinese road infrastructure, which is probably very necessary. But I think also... it'll come to pass. I think that everyone knows we've waited too long for this. Now, I think the other problem was that the Ugandans were playing hardball on tax, and then Tullo, and Tullo backed out, and then I think I wouldn't be surprised if that visit of the Total boss was to do Tullo. I think they're close to making a deal. Agreement on the tax, and so I think probably there's Museveni is also now is compromising, needs to compromise or wants to compromise because he wants to get the thing running.
I want to just finish up with your final thoughts about East Africa, because you've described a period of being in Tanzania, you've known all these years, Uganda, you've been deeply embedded there, Kenya, where you've run businesses all these years. You know, if we look at East Africa from an economic economist's point of view, it was called the bright spot by Lagarde in 2014. We were seen as more promising in many respects than South Africa, which has been in the doldrums for quite a while. West Africa, and are you optimistic about where we're going? If you look at leadership today, from Magufulinomics to Salva Kiir to Museveni, do you think a change is coming? What do you, how would you characterize this moment in East Africa's history from where you're sitting?
Well, I think first of all, you have to see you also have to take the long view. Right now there's some stasis in East Africa, in the economies of East Africa. But if you look back 35 years, in the mid-80s, Tanzania was in the doldrums, as I mentioned earlier. Uganda was in the throes of anarchy. Kenya was suffering under the regime of President Moi, which was a very rapacious and bureaucratic and regime that was crushing the Kenyan economy. The three main countries of East Africa, Tanzania, Uganda, and Kenya, have all made dramatic progress in the last 35 years. Living standards have massively improved. Quality of life, there's FM radio now, TV everywhere, everyone's got mobile phones. If you take Kenya, it's the biggest user of mobile money in the world. The countries have made huge progress. Okay, there's a lot of, there's some social issues. I think corruption has become a very serious problem in Kenya, in Uganda, Tanzania. But I think if you look at it in the context of this very positive trajectory of the last 35 years, I'm sure some of these problems will become resolved and then the progress will continue.
You're optimistic.
Yes.
It's been a real pleasure, William, speaking with you today.
Thank you for coming.
I'm very grateful. And this is William's book, Combatants, A Memoir of the Bush War in the Press in Uganda, William Pike. And William, just tell us where you can buy it in Nairobi.
You can buy it in Nairobi. You can get it at Bookstop in Yaya Center, Prestige Bookshop in CBD. In Uganda, you can get it at Aristock or in Tebe Airport Bookshop. And if you're abroad, you can get it either as a paperback or Kindle from Amazon.
Fantastic. Thank you very, very much, William. That was great.
Cheers.
Thank you.